Joining me now, Brooklyn Councilman Justin Brannan. So, Councilman, thank you so much for being here on Picks on Politics. First appearance. Good to have you.
Oh, good to have you. I watch the show all the time, so it's cool to be on.
Well, appreciate it. So, congrats, by the way, on the win. But it was certainly closer than I'm sure you would have liked, winning by about 300-plus votes, right? So you tweeted, I'm going to throw this up here, quote, "We won despite being up against a red wave driven by misinformation, lies, and one of the dirtiest campaigns Southern Brooklyn has ever seen. We prevailed," end quote. Well, let me ask you this. With a close race, does this actually change your approach to how you govern within your next term?
No, not at all. I mean, we really always put the faith and trust ultimately in the voter to see through the lies, to listen through the noise. And we were always focused on delivering for our constituents. Mm-hmm. So once all the votes are counted, I'm probably going to win by just about what I won by the first time in 2017. Democrats in Southern Brooklyn, we fight very hard. We fight for every vote, and we don't win by landslides down here. So we prepare accordingly, and that's what we did this time. And everything worked out according to plan. We ran.
Yeah. So let me stay on that topic. What you just kind of mentioned there, because your opponent Brian Fox conceded, saying that the Republican movement in Brooklyn is just getting started. But like you said, it's always a tough win, right? Including although they did flip some seats. There was a big win by Ina Vernikoff in Sheepshead Bay, and then there was this red wave across the country. So what do you see happening within the Democratic Party?
Well, I think it's a bunch of things, right? I think leading up to the election, people were upset about the vaccine mandate, the timing of it, at least, the way the mayor rolled that out was a disaster. And I think overall, nationally, there's a sentiment of people are tired of COVID. They want to get back to normal. We're just not there yet. Yeah. And there's a sentiment that the Democrats have the ball, but we're not moving it down the field fast enough. And unfortunately, those national wins clearly blow into local city council elections. But thankfully, I run a serious constituent service operation because ultimately that's my job. And that's why we were able to prevail.
So let me ask you this, because there's a lot of talk about bail reform, right? And a lot of Republicans ran on the issue of bail reform, whether or not the laws need to change or be revisited. And there's this talk happening in Albany. What do you think of the current bail laws, and how do you see it impacting Brooklyn?
I think it's still too soon to say. We need to look at the data to see how the bail reform changes have affected crime in our city. I think it's easy to get blinded by the tabloids and the large print and the misinformation that's out there that blames bail reform for every damn thing. I think it's impossible not to see everything mm-hmm. through the lens of a global pandemic. We had a complete catastrophic breakdown of the social safety net. How do you not look at that? How do you blame everything on bail reform and not on the fact that we had a global pandemic where people were struggling and out of work and food insecure for the first time in their lives? Why aren't we talking about that?
Yeah, I mean, there's certainly a lot to talk about, which brings me to what do you see as priority number one for this relatively new council? A lot of them are new members.
Priority number one is just getting back to basics, delivering city services, being there for our most vulnerable, getting the garbage picked up, connecting people with the services and support that they need, getting back to basic city services, getting back to all the services that you pay taxes for, and then we can go back to really being a laboratory for democracy.
So there's a lot of talk about who will become the next speaker. Obviously, you have thrown your hat in the ring for that job, correct? So do you think the race being as close as it was against your opponent hurts your chances of being speaker?
Not at all. I mean, I never thought I was going to win by a landslide. We never told anyone we were going to win by a landslide. We prepared for it, and we won exactly as we thought we were going to win. And this shows that I'm a fighter. It shows I'm battle tested. It shows that I know what it takes to win elections. I know what our incoming members are going to need to get reelected in 2 years and ultimately to deliver for their constituents. That's what it's all about, delivering for the people who elected you to serve.
And that's what you would bring to the speakership. I have to ask you this, and this may come as a surprise and out of left field here, but if you were to not win the speakership, are you interested in a higher office? Would you look at running against Nicole Malliotakis for Congress?
Not really anything I'm thinking about right now. I love being a city guy, running for higher office. I was never planning to run for anything, right? I grew up listening to the Ramones and AC/DC. I didn't have pictures of JFK on my wall. So I was never really supposed to be here in the first place. Mm-hmm. I was driven to serve. I love helping people. But running for higher office is really not something I'm interested in.
Understood. Hey, I appreciate you being. Do you still have the band?
Yeah, well, we don't play much anymore, but we usually play a couple charity events a year, but because of COVID, we've been sidelined.
There you go. All right, we'll have to have you on to play sometime. Councilman Brandon, appreciate you being here, okay? First appearance on Fix It Politics.
Thank you, brother.
Yep.